Hi everyone, we're here at Rad Industries and today I want to talk about the 2JZ motor. Frequently I get asked the difference between the GTE and the GE. There are some other differences between a VVTI, non-VVTI, and I want to get into all these details today and help you guys understand stuff that I've learned over the years of working on these motors, modifying them, building race motors, and kind of getting inside them a lot. I would start off talking about is the turbo motor. So this is a 2JZ GTE non-VVTI. This would have been the most probably famous one that you see the most of. It's in the turbo Supras in the US. We also have the VVTI version here. So this is the 2JZ GTE VVTI. This never made it to America in a car, a production car that was sold on the road of America, but this is very similar to this, slight differences, we'll talk about that later, but lots of these were imported into the US from Japan. Over on this side, we have the 2JZ GE. This is the non-VVTI, the first version of the GE. This was sold in mini cars in America. A little change happened and it turned into the 2JZ GE with VVTI. And this was also sold in mini cars in America. Now, let's talk about what's different on the inside of them. First, let me tell you real quick. So these motors were developed in 1991. They were in cars in Japan and maybe a couple other countries in 92. They were not in America till mid 93. I might be wrong slightly on that. They might've came on an NA in late 92, but let's just say they started coming to America in 93, very quickly started becoming kind of famous for being able to, on this one particularly, this is the turbo version, of being able to handle a lot of horsepower and they didn't blow up, they're reliable, and it was easy to make power with them. Then once the fame behind it started growing, people, were interested. And they liked the motor because it could do what you ask it and just ridiculous horsepower numbers without building the bottom end of it. That fame still goes on with it today. It is an old design from, 25 plus years old, but still doing a good job at being reliable and making horsepower. So for those of you that ask me, what is the difference of an NA versus turbo version of, you're probably mostly speaking of the block, but you might also be asking about the head. So I want to dive into that. With this one, it has 8.5 to 1 compression pistons, and it just has pretty stout rods, and the crank is like definitely over-engineered. It has an iron block, and then it's just pretty simple. It just has dual overhead cam, 4 valves per cylinder. There's nothing major that would fail, and it has good oil drain back. It just works. The oil pump doesn't fail. It just works. So it's reliable, and you're not gonna bend rods when you're trying to make 600 plus horsepower. You could probably nowadays with the good tuners out there and the right engine management system, make 750 horsepower, 100% stock reliable for many years, as long as it's good engine management system and good fuel system. If we went from this one to its evolution into its last version, which this one was made up until 2006, in Japan, we only saw these motors until 98. We never even got to see the VVTI because it came out in basically 97 in Japan and they were gonna start shipping them in 98. And we just didn't have any more Supras over here, which was the only turbo car or turbo chassis that Toyota or Lexus was gonna offer it in. In 98, let's say 97 to 2006, this was produced overseas and in Japan mostly, but the changes were done to the intake cam, so it has variable valve timing on the intake cam, which was creating better low-end response, mid-range response, so you didn't have as much turbo lag. The end result of horsepower is the same amount of horsepower, just because it's still the stock twins, which this one in the US was making 320. In other countries, except in some European countries, it was making 280 horsepower because they had a little bit different turbos. Usually when these motors are worked on, people throw those away. And they put a bigger single turbo, or maybe they put big twins, but the easy route would be a big single turbo, more boost, more fuel, better engine management, and then you get more horsepower. You can always build it and make well over 1,000 horsepower, no problem. The block can handle it. It's a fat cast iron block, and it has 7 mains. So you put billet main caps, you kind of go up to 2,000 if you wanted. Let's get into the differences between the NA versus the turbo blocks. Let's start over here with this non-VVTI GE block. is like the old school version of everything, and Toyota was just probably being simple and they left a distributor on here, which in my opinion, I would not choose this one. If I was gonna pick an NA block, I would go without the distributor. But this is still a really reliable motor. It doesn't really have too many issues. They'll drive 200,000 miles, no problem. They'll go 300,000 miles if you do your maintenance and like change your timing belt and stuff. No problem. They'll probably go further than that if you were very particular with your maintenance. The differences with this one comparing to the turbo, the GE, they have 10.5:1 compression. This makes it an interference motor. So if you snap a timing belt, your cam's rotating, pushing the valves down, you're gonna hit a valve into the top of the piston because it just doesn't have the room in there. As for this motor, both of these GE motors are non-interference until you put a bigger cam in it or whatever when you're building a race motor. But in stock form, if you broke your timing belt, just realign the timing, put a new timing belt, and you're good to go. So these ones, they were trying to produce a little bit more horsepower, and that's why they did higher compression, because they don't have a turbo, and it was probably pretty lazy if they left the 8.5:1. So they did 10.5:1 compression, making this one make right around 220 horsepower. There is different variations and different chassis, and the Lexus, I think, made 215 possibly, and then there's certain ones that made 230 with like this one. Still not a lot of horsepower, so it's between like 215 and 230 horsepower right here on these NA ones. This particular one, where it's the non-VVTI, it has the same crank as the turbo motor. It has the same rods as the turbo motor, so it has pretty stout rods, but you have high compression pistons, and they're not forged, they're just OEM pistons, so they're not really made for boosted applications. People do turbo these, but you're not taking this up to 700 horsepower. You're gonna detonate a piston, or you're going to have other issues because it doesn't have oil squirters. Nowadays, people are taking these and, you know, refreshing it a little bit, or they'll take these ones. But the idea of this video is to explain how you could get into a JZ cheap and maybe, you know, build yourself your dream power plant out of it. But you do have to do a couple things to it. You can stick with this one with the distributor. If you can find the VVTI, I would head that route. But there's some downfalls of the VVTI. We'll get into that in a second. There is no oil squirters. There's also no oil feed on this side of the block because there was no turbo. So you don't need an oil feed for a non-turbo. You needed it on the turbo to feed your turbo. So there was oil out of the block. You could break it down, take it to a machinist and have him machine the spot for the oil feed and machine in where you're gonna do oil squirters. That sounds like a lot of work. So what guys would do is take oil from that side, they'll put a turbo on it, and they'll cap this around like 400. Some people have been pushing 500 horsepower. If you're running ethanol-based fuel, you could probably get away with it because it's colder. The idea of the oil squirter is to cool the back of the piston, the underside of the piston, and it helps with pump gas. That's the differences here. If you were going to do the ideal NAT build, you would almost want this one, but then let me tell you what's not great about this one. So this one makes 230 horsepower, but Toyota kind of got smart over the years, I guess, and so they weren't over-engineering it. It does have the same crank, so the crank is good to go for well over 1,000 horsepower if you wanted. The rest of the motor, not so much. The block is the same casting as is this one was, so the block and the crank are good, but you have 10.5:1 compression, you have lighter weight rods in this one, which is probably to like help it rev out and do a little bit more horsepower, and then just to be lighter so it's more efficient. And you still have the high compression pistons, which aren't good for turbo applications. If you went over 400, you're gonna blow this one up and probably break a rod and ruin your block. What you would want to do on this one is take it apart and put, maybe you could buy pistons and rods and go back together. And if you had aftermarket pistons, you don't really need oil squirters because they're gonna be able to sustain more heat because they're forged pistons. But you would have to go through the time of tearing it down, rebuilding it. And at that point, you're probably gonna put some new things like bearings and whatnot, oil pump when you're in there, the price might go up. But this would be a better starting point because then you don't have a distributor in this one, and you could do individual coil packs. And once you've built up the rods and the pistons and maybe you do main caps, you could go over 750 horsepower. That should give you guys a little bit of info. So think on this one, weak rods, not great pistons for turbo. This one, it has not the right pistons, the rods and the rest of it, I guess, are okay, but then you have the distributor, so If you do an NAT on either one of these, and it's called NAT, that's just what people were calling it because they're taking the NA and they're turboing it. You would have more luck with more horsepower with this one, but then you get more headache with some added things in there. So if you're willing to spend a little bit of time and money to do the refresh, I would go this route. We are gonna do a build series on breaking this one down, rebuilding it, and I'm gonna do some modifications to make this a turbo-like friendly setup, and I'm gonna explain why and how I do it, so that'll be coming up in the next month or so, and I have a couple of these that we're gonna do it on. That should answer the majority of the simple questions on there. Things that are not interchangeable, let me just real quick go over non-interchangeable things. The heads on both the NA are completely different. They made it have a little bit better flow because it's higher compression. They're trying to get the maximum out of an NA. So the head is not exactly the same as these ones. It will bolt up to the motor, but your exhaust and intake manifold both have a different bolt pattern, so they're not interchangeable. Those are some things to know. The water pumps are different, and the water in and out of the head is on the opposite side. This one comes out of, it would be US driver's side, and the turbo comes out of US passenger side. If you guys look close, this has a couple of our Rad Industries billet parts that we sell on our website. We're definitely into Jay-Z's over here, and we're gonna start making some parts for these non-turbo motors, mostly this one because it has the VVTI, which is gonna help spool. Cool thing about these ones is you're kind of getting, the head is really good. So it's almost like you ported like a mild port on the head and you have VVTI, but these are pretty cheap to get as of now. And as we all know, these things have skyrocketed and they're almost not worth paying what they're asking for. They want you to pay $6,000 for this and you still got to refresh stuff on it. So I'm trying to come up with solutions to help you guys get into a Jay-Z cheap as they used to be like a couple months back or years back. So that was a quick run through on the 2JZ GTE motor versus the 2JZ GE motor and the small differences and what you guys need to know. So hopefully that answered your questions, guys. Thanks for watching.